This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a really fun episode for you today. The title today is The Dentist Entrepreneur. Got lots of cool information to share with you about that. But before we get to that, I have a couple announcements to make. The first announcement coming up shortly after this one is published, we have our last Masterclass of 2022. This is happening on December 6th from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. And this Masterclass is titled, Grow Your Practice 10% or More in 2023 and Beyond. We timed that Masterclass very specifically because we know that many dentists are making plans for next year, making very specific actionable plans for next year. And we thought the Masterclass would be lots of information they can apply to their planning for 2023. And you guys know that I'm a big believer that practices are either growing or they're dying. And if they're growing, given those two choices, I want to be growing. Some might say, well, there's a third option. You can stay the same. But as we know right now, especially in an inflationary cycle, you're going backwards. So we got to be growing. And I want to grow by at least double-digit percentage growth every year. That means at least 10% or more. Hey, come join us for that Masterclass, 3 hours. It's a live stream format. It's one evening, 3 hours. Get 3 hours of CE. If any of you need CE before the end of the year, that's a great opportunity for that. You'll get 3 hours of actionable information that you can apply immediately in your practice. Go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. Would love to see you there. All right, the second announcement, we have a returning guest, very dear friend of mine, longtime friend of mine, Art Wiederman. Some of you will recognize that name, and you should. This is what we call a dental CPA insight. And he's going to share a wonderful insight that'll help you. Art is one of the founding members of the Academy of Dental CPAs, and he's going to share some information with you about the golden rules of financial planning. I would strongly encourage you to follow Art's advice because I've seen the results of that advice in many common clients. But without any further ado, here's Art Wiederman on the golden rules of financial planning.
Hello, my name is Art Wiederman, and I'm a dental division director at the CPA firm of Eide Bailly, and I'm one of the founding members of the Academy of Dental CPAs. And my financial tip today is a financial planning tip. I have what I call Art's Golden Rules, and I've lectured on these rules for almost 40 years. And I've shared these with thousands and thousands of dentists, not only at lectures, but on my podcast and webinars. And I want to give you a couple of these rules, two or three, that hopefully will help you towards your financial planning. My first golden rule is what I call my 65-25-10 rule. And that rule says that you live on 65% of what you earn. You're going to pay about 25% in taxes of what you earn. And we'd like to see you saving about 10% of your income. We don't want you going by the 90-25-15 rule, which is you live on 90% of what you make, you struggle to pay your taxes, and then the minus 15% means you go into credit card debt. So we want you staying out of credit card debt. That's a good rule that I like to have my clients live by. The next one has to do with emergency savings fund. You guys should all have at least 3 to 6 months of liquid savings, whether it's in a money market fund, a savings account, a checking account, a cash value life insurance, whatever it is, so that if you get disabled and you're unable to work and your disability insurance maybe doesn't kick in for 90 days, then you've got enough money to continue to be able to pay your bills. So 3 to 6 months from an emergency savings fund standard. The next tip has to do with planning your retirement base and taking advantage of retirement vehicles. So I tell everybody that we need to set a plan up by the time you're ready to retire, that could be 50, 55, 60, 65, 80, whatever the year is that you want to retire, you want to shoot for a goal. Now, a good goal would allow you to take about 5%, 4 to 5% of your nest egg out. And what I mean by that is this. Let's say you get to 65 and you have $3 million saved in your retirement fund. That would allow you to take out somewhere between $120,000 and $150,000 a year. And generally, considering what money earns in investments and inflation, and again, forget about what inflation is doing in 2022, folks. The average rate of inflation for the last 100 years has been 2 to 3%. And the average rate of return on investments in the stock market have been 7 to 9% over the last 100 years. So we take that, the rate of return minus inflation, that's where we get 4 to 5%. So that's what you should be planning on. If you think you can live on $120,000 to $150,000, you have to adjust that for inflation, plus maybe your Social Security, then that's a good retirement base to plan for. I also want you to take maximum advantage of tax-deferred retirement vehicles. As a private practice dentist, if you own your practice, you have an incredible opportunity to take money on an annual basis, put it into a tax-deferred retirement plan, take a tax deduction for it now. So if you put $60,000 into a retirement plan today and you can deduct that on your tax return, if you live in the state that I'm from, by the way, I'm from Tustin, California. That's where our office is. You could be looking at 40% tax. The government's paying for 40% of your retirement contributions. So that means that $60,000 really only costs you about $36,000 because the government's giving you a tax deduction, and you'll save taxes on that. So I want you to take the maximum possible advantage that you can of your tax-deferred retirement plan. That could be a SEP IRA, which is not the best for most of you. That could be a profit sharing with a 401k or a defined benefit or a simple IRA plan. So those are a few of my financial tips that I think will be helpful to you. And the last thing I want to do is to encourage you to sit down with a financial planner. Someone from the ADCPA can help you. And figure out where you're going to be, because I'll tell you what, it's really nice to be able to retire. And if you want to keep working, you can, but to have the plan in place is something you really need to do. Again, I'm Art Wiederman, a dental division director from Ide Bailey, located in Tustin, California. And good luck with your retirement plan.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host of the Thriving Dentist podcast. Art, thank you for that tip. We really appreciate it. I know over the years, you've given us a lot of tips and we've gotten a lot of people writing to us and saying how they appreciate your wisdom and your 40 years of experience. Today's topic is the dentist entrepreneur. I love this topic, Gary, because I am an entrepreneur and I think you are an entrepreneur, and I think pretty much anything good that's happening in this country, whether it's Canada or US, it's happening because of entrepreneurs, because they are the ones who are creating new things. They are the ones who are pushing the envelopes. They are the ones who are moving us forward. So just like there are entrepreneurs, there are dentist entrepreneurs. So dentist entrepreneurs are people, in my mind, and I want you to clarify it, are people who are saying, you know what, I'm really good at running a practice, but can I do more of this? Can I, you know, add more value to more people? So it's going to be a wonderful conversation about who is a dentist entrepreneur, you know, perhaps even tips and ideas about how you can become one and grow as one. So I'm looking forward to this, Gary.
Yeah, Naren, I'm excited about this topic as well. And there's many different ways that a dentist can be an entrepreneur. For example, they could be an inventor, where they invent something that could be, you know, used in dentistry. Like the mad scientist that comes up with the next thing. And there's other examples of dental entrepreneurs that have, come up with a better mouse trap. In other words, something they're using in their own practice. My favorite example of a dental entrepreneur is the founder of UltraDent. And, you know, he started, Dan started years ago, when he graduated from dental school, is whatever way he was using in 1975 for controlling bleeding in the mouth wasn't working. And so he needed to control, you know, the bleeding in the mouth so he could do better dentistry. And whatever he had wasn't working. So he was a bit of a scientist, a bit of a mad scientist. So he goes in his basement, laboratory and starts formulating, different components and comes up with what became known as Viscostat. Everybody in dentistry knows what Viscostat is. It's like the best product on the market for stopping bleeding in the mouth. And he took it to all the different, he started using it in his own practice. He started sharing it with his classmates and neighbors, dentists around him. And they said, this works fantastic. You ought to take it to a manufacturer and have them carry this. And then he went to all the dental manufacturers and they all said, no, thanks. Whatever we have is working fine. We don't need your thing. Well, he wasn't going to be foiled. So he decided, in the great American tradition, decided to do it himself. And that's how Ultra Dent started. And it's a wonderful, wonderful story. But I'm really not talking about that kind of entrepreneurship. I want to guide this a little more specifically. There could be many ways of a dentist to be an entrepreneur. But I'm not really thinking of that format, although I do have keen respect for Dan. However, I'm thinking more in terms of a dentist that has done a really good job of developing a successful practice. And likely this is also a dentist that also enjoys business. Sometimes even has an MBA, but is not required. But maybe they also gravitate and enjoy business. So it's a dentist who enjoys the clinical side of dentistry, but also enjoys the business side. And they decide that, I would like to serve more patients, help more patients enjoy the benefits of great oral health, and I'd like to expand to more than one location. And so what they started with one location, they go to another, and then perhaps another and another. That's really the brand of a dental entrepreneur that I'd like to talk about in this podcast episode. And I'm especially motivated. There's a reason why we're talking about this today, Naren. And that's that 2 weeks ago, I had a wonderful experience. I was invited to be the master of ceremonies for a conference that was in Nashville called the DSO Leadership Summit, And the doctors that attended that leadership summit were a particular group. These were dentists that had anywhere from 3 to 30 locations. Now, there were outliers beyond that, but that was the apex of the bell-shaped curve of the attendance at that conference. So these are dentists, dentist-owned DSOs, where they have anywhere from 3 to 30 locations. And by the way, these were dentists that, as I studied, we had 500 attendees there. It was invitation only, had 500 attendees. And as I got to meet these dentists, they spanned, you might be surprised, Naren, they were across every age segment in dentistry. There were young dentists that were part of this. There were mid-career dentists, and there were late-career dentists that were part of this conference. Does that surprise you at all, Naren, or is that something you might have expected?
Yeah, I would have expected it because I think more and more young people are entrepreneurs. Just because I think their role models are like Elon Musk and Steve Jobs growing up. So I guess they are like they want to be like that guy who's an entrepreneur.
And one of the things I also noticed is that there can be many, many motivations for doing this. But when I met with many of these doctors individually at that conference, one of the things that I noticed is they had a very good practice culture about serving people, serving patients, serving their community, right, serving their team. In other words, this was not just an economic play to make more money. By the way, there's nothing wrong with that. Naren, you're a capitalist. Yes?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm a capitalist.
Yes.
I'm a absolute advocate of capitalism as the best economic system on the planet. And I believe that all of our listeners are capitalists as well, except for those that are running nonprofits.
Right.
And if they're running a nonprofit, they're running a nonprofit not by choice, sadly. So if we have any listeners that are running a nonprofit not by choice, listen to more podcasts because it needs to be a for-profit enterprise. All right. So, but I do want to emphasize that the majority of the attendees and everyone I met with, they had a service heart. They were interested in serving others, serving more patients, serving their community, serving their team members. And I love that position to start this from. Now, certainly there's economic rewards as well. No denying that. But so if you're listening to this and you're thinking that might be something I want to do, what would be the pathway to do that? I'm going to make a very, very opinionated suggestion here. I think before you think of adding locations, adding another location, the first thing that you should do is you should develop a mothership, a practice that serves as a proof of concept, and develop that mothership to full potential. Now, Naren, as I met many of these dental entrepreneurs at that conference in Nashville, that was exactly what they did. So have you ever heard that saying, Naren, that if you want to be successful, do what successful people do?
Yes.
You know, many of them said, when you know, we had panel discussions, and we'd have panel discussions, and it might be, hey, tell your story. Tell a story of how you got from where you were to where you are today. And in many cases, they said just that. Well, I had one practice. I wanted to optimize that and develop the full potential. I wanted to get good systems in place. Wanted to have good team members. And once we had that, then we started looking at other opportunities. So I'm using that in the kind of creative terminology I'll use is called the mothership. So now you have your mothership in place. Now, is a practice ever fully optimized? What do you think, Naren?
No, I personally, as an entrepreneur, I believe that business is a work in progress. You can continue to improve it. You can continue to go after new opportunities. So it's like never done.
Yeah, you're always going to get better. But there should reach a point where you say, hey, we've got something here that's really cool. We're gonna work on getting better tomorrow, but we've got something here that's pretty cool. Let's look for another opportunity.
And let's saying, like, let's say you get it to an 80, 90% state, like of what perfect is. Now you are duplicating it. You are like doing plus one now and then plus scale. One.
Yeah, now you can scale. You know, I happen to think, I'm going to get kind of granular with you. I happen to think that the best, you know, model in a practice is to have two or more doctors in the practice. It could be, if it's two, it could be an owner and an associate. It could be partners in the practice. For lots of reasons, we can cover more hours for our patients. We can provide more hours for our team members that need that. And providing a work-life balance for our doctors and our team, you know, in a model like that. And you can develop that practice, you know, fully with two doctors. I would also be mindful of expenses as you do this. And I would be thinking about optimizing your space as well. In terms of, you know, you don't necessarily need a huge office to be able to do this. A two-doctor office could be a six-operatory office. Ideally, I'd like one more. I'd like seven to give us a little bit more growth possibility. But, you know, a seven operatory office, Naren, is not a necessarily a big office. And it's not going to have a big, you know, real estate investment or a big lease cost in terms of that office space. Does that make sense?
It makes sense.
Yeah. And then scale. And you can scale a number of different ways. One way that you can scale is you can go out and acquire another practice. You know, buy one and add it to your group. Another way is you can do a de novo, do a startup. De novos can still be done, but they have to be done much more, research has to be much more complete with doing a de novo. You have to make sure that you know, the area isn't saturated with dentists, that there's an opportunity to start from scratch and grow. However, the many of these doctors, as they told their story, as they talked about their growth, they actually used a combination, Naren. Acquisition and startups in some way, shape, or form. But now imagine that we're doing acquisitions, we're doing startups, and there's a third opportunity to grow. And that third opportunity to grow is to grow same practice growth, you know, really optimize each individual practice and have same store growth. Now, because I know our listeners are kind of tuned into this kind of thing, I want to share a potential model with you. And imagine that each location you could grow into somewhere between a $2.5 and $3 million annual practice in terms of collections. And that would be two doctors and a strong hygiene department. Could be done in six operatories. Seven would be even better. Somewhere between $2.5 and $3 million in annual collections. That's something that two doctors and a strong hygiene department could do. That would be a wonderful model to grow your practice on. Now, let's introduce another term that for some of our listeners will be familiar with, others this will be new information. You want to pay close attention to the term EBITDA, E-B-I-T-D-A, earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, amortization. And ideally, you're looking for earnings in your practice to be in the 18 to 20% range or higher, 18 to 20%. And doctor, as an owner dentist, one of the ways that you have to set up your accounting is that you pay yourself as a dentist like you would any other dentist in your practice. So if you're paying your associate 30% of collections, you pay yourself 30% of your collections. And then you'll also have the earnings from your practice. Hopefully those earnings will be 18 to 20%. That would be the goal, to get them there. And then that's also your income as well if you're the owner. But I want you to think about paying yourself as a dentist. That's something that most dentists don't do. Now, Naren, I know you don't look at profit loss statements every day, but is what I'm talking about making sense?
Absolutely, Gary. It's making total sense.
Yeah. And then now when we talk about growing, we can either acquire a practice and grow. We can start a practice and grow. Or if we have multiple locations, we can grow each one. And so when it comes to buying a practice, I happen to think that there's a sweet spot. If you're going to acquire, I happen to think there's a sweet spot in the size of practice to look at buying. Now, again, there could be all kinds of wiggle room on this based on what you're finding in your market. But I like the idea of buying an $800,000 practice in collections. That's kind of a sweet spot because you can put an associate in that practice and that practice will cash flow from day one, has enough dentistry to cash flow from day one. And I would look at growing that $800,000 practice to 2.5 to 3 in as short a period of time as possible. This is something we often do in my coaching work. You know, some of our listeners may not know, we have in my coaching, we have a variety of types of clients. We have private practice dentists that are looking at optimizing their practice. That's certainly a strong element of our coaching. But we also work with doctors that want to put together a small group. And I've seen this happen where they follow my advice. They look for $800,000 practices to buy. And over a period, this would be aggressive and this would require a lot of focus. But that practice grows to 2.5 to 3 in 3 to 4 years. That's pretty attractive, wouldn't you say, Naren?
It is totally attractive. Talking about growth, Gary, it is probably from a return on investment standpoint, it could be the most lucrative thing you can do, right? Because when you buy a practice, you're going to pay a lot of money. And if you're going to do a startup and then grow it again, you're going to spend a lot of money in leasehold improvements and then getting those first 1,000, 2,000 patients. But if you, let's say, buy a practice that's already doing 1 million, and you can make it do 1.5 million or reduce your expenses, like your marketing expenses, instead of PPO, you get Google patients. Those extra dollars and the extra profits can be very lucrative for an entrepreneur.
Profitability on your growth dollars is so much better than profitability on your first dollars because you already covered all your fixed expenses. Right. And so if you want to maximize your EBITDA, there's two very specific strategies I want you to focus on. And this is what we teach our clients to do. Number one would be to revisit the insurance profile of the practice. Most practices that you buy that is $800,000 are going to be PPO practices. In fact, maybe your mothership is still a PPO practice. If it is, you're going to have a hard time getting your EBITDA to 18 to 20%. You know, it can be done, but you have to pedal so fast and you incur all that extra overhead because you're giving away 45 to 50% that it's the hard way to do this.
Right.
What I would strongly encourage you to do is look at reducing your insurance dependence. You don't necessarily have to go all the way if that scares you to go all the way to fee for service. Get it. I always tell my clients that we want to help you reduce your insurance dependence. If your goal is to go all the way free for service, I'm going to be your biggest cheerleader because that's where you're going to get the best end result. But you don't have to go all the way to see very significant improvement right. in your profitability. So look at reducing that footprint, that insurance footprint, because that'll enhance your model. Look at doing that in your mothership first before you expand, because now you've got the proof of concept that you could do it and you've had experience doing it. And the next time is going to be easier. The next time, the next time, the next time, it's going to be easier. And then the second thing you want to do is you want to have a proven engine to supply you with new patients, because we're not going to count on Delta anymore to provide us new patients. You're going to go to a better source by any way you want to look at the Delta. You know what that better source is, Naren? It's Google. So you want to have great marketing, digital marketing, and you want to have the way I think to do that today in 2022 and beyond is maximizing your search engine optimization, your organic search engine optimization. So you're not paying Google, but you're showing up on page one because you've earned it. And that's where all of a sudden, you know, multiple locations can really play in your favor and you can dominate Google. And if you want to do that, just do what we did and do what we recommend to our clients and use Equa. Use your firm, Naren, to do that. But there's some ideas there. Look for the $800,000 practice to buy. It's also in kind of a bit of a no man's land as practices that are for sale, Naren.
Yes.
What I mean by that is it's beyond the scope of most young doctors, you know, that are relatively recent out of school. They don't think they can handle a practice or maybe not even achieve the financing to buy that practice. And they're also below the radar of the DSOs that are buying up practices, because they usually like to see at least $1 million to $1.2 million in revenue. So they kind of represent that middle ground where, you know, the young doctors aren't buying it, the corporates aren't buying it, and they kind of sit on the market a little bit longer. And there's lots of those available in near you to grow your practice.
Right.
Well, this dental entrepreneur model, it's not for everyone. Let's be clear about that. It's absolutely not for everyone. In fact, I would say there's a minority percentage of dentists that would be even interested in this. But if you are a dentist that enjoys business, that enjoys team development, that enjoys the business challenge of running a practice, then this might be something you take a look at. And especially, I'll bring it back full circle, if you do this from a service heart, where you know you want to serve more patients, you want to help more patients have great oral health, you want to serve more people in your community or wherever your expansion community is, and you want to serve your team members, you want to create a place for them where they can thrive. There's all kinds of good reasons to be doing that, and the financial reward of all that is very impressive. Naren, why don't we hit pause here? I hope I've sparked some interest in the idea of our listeners becoming dental entrepreneurs. And let's go to the Q&A segment and dive a little bit deeper into some of the details that were asked in those questions.
That was an amazing coaching and action segment, Gary. Let's jump into the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. I have four questions for you. Let me ask you the first question. When I'm evaluating potential practice acquisitions, what are the most important criteria that I should consider?
What a great question. And it's a loaded question because there are many variables to consider, for sure. But I think one of the most important variables is to try to evaluate the untapped potential of that practice. Let me give you some examples. So you want to buy a practice that's underperforming. I mean, that was the story of our Life Smiles practice. Life Smiles was a dopey little practice that was really underperforming. But we recognized, Paul and I recognized, that it had massive potential. But you never want to pay for potential, but you want to make sure it's there, you know, so you can achieve that potential. Here's some ideas of looking at potential. One would be, is there a narrow scope of services? So for example, maybe the dentist in that practice, there's a lot of things they don't do. Maybe they don't do endo, they don't see kids, they don't do any adult ortho. All three of those represent growth opportunities if you can add those services to the practice. And you can even quantify, a potential is a bit elusive, Naren.
Right.
It doesn't usually just, you know, hit you over the head. But in this case, it could kind of hit you over the head. You could look at how, let's say the dentist you're going to put into that practice has some skills providing endodontic treatment. And we could look at a referral report from the practice you're buying and then look at how much endo was sent out, you know, in the form of a referral report. And maybe your doctor doesn't do 100% of that, but maybe they're going to do 70 or 75% of it. You can make a calculation of what endo you might be able to keep in-house. So look for a practice that maybe has a narrow scope of services. Maybe we look at a practice, Naren, that another way to evaluate potential is that they're really just on kind of a just getting by with new patient flow, just barely getting by. You know, maybe they see 10 to 15 new patients a month. And they're not growing because that 10 to 15 new patients a month just is not providing the opportunity to grow the practice. And if we can inject some marketing, you know, into that practice, you know, that number could double, triple. And all of a sudden that represents an opportunity for growth as well. So you want to kind of do your best detective cap, put your, you know, Sherlock Holmes cap on, and look where there's untapped potential in that practice. And any practice that's plateaued, say at that $800,000 mark that I mentioned in the coaching and action segment, would likely have a lot more potential in it. Another way we can evaluate potential is look at unscheduled treatment plans. So this would be treatment that's been recommended but remains unscheduled. Now, there could be a lot of reasons why the treatment remains unscheduled, but one of the big reasons might be the doctor's ability to communicate with the patients about recommended treatment. So imagine that you've got a doc that just isn't very good at that, and now you're going to put a doctor in that practice that has some better skills at that. Then we can start to untap those unscheduled treatment plans and use that as an opportunity to grow. I get kind of excited when I've helped many, many, many young doctors buy their practices, you know, in terms of evaluate the practices they're looking at. And when I see a practice that's smacking of potential, you know, I want to give two big thumbs up, jump right in here, because man, this practice is one that's just reeking of potential. You want to avoid, let's talk about what to avoid. You want to avoid a played out practice, a played out practice. And Aaron, do you know what that term means in this context?
I would love for you to explain it, Gary.
What I mean by that is that there is very little treatment left to be done in this practice. Mm. Years ago, one of my clients was looking to buy a practice. And I evaluated and I said, you know, I'm not excited about this practice. When we look at the existing patients, almost every one of them are restored. Almost every one of them are completely restored. There's not going to be much opportunity to come into hygiene and cultivate treatment recommendations out of hygiene because everybody's restored. Virtually everyone was, Naren. My client chose to buy this practice anyway. It's because it was exactly where he wanted to practice. He kind of fell in love with the building. He had an opportunity to buy the building as well. Fell in love with the building. And and that's where he wanted to practice. And I'm not saying that was a bad idea, but he went through five very difficult years in his first 5 years of practice ownership because this practice did not provide, and it took him a while to figure out marketing and figure that out. And he finally, and it all ended well. And he's happy he purchased that practice, but man, those first 5 years were hard, very, very hard.
You know, speaking of that potential and marketing, like I was just thinking of this one particular client, Gary, husband and wife team. Husband is the manager and the wife is a dentist. He bought one practice. I mean, the wife is already in one practice. They became a client of ours 7 years ago. And I remember an acquisition they made 2.5 years ago. He goes to this town called Waterloo, which is like an hour from his main practice. And he buys this practice for $300,000 because the dentist was struggling. They were not getting enough new patients. He was barely making ends meet. He comes in. He knows how to make marketing work because he knows what we did with the other practice. He said, turn on marketing, turn on systems. Boom, in 2 years, that practice is now worth $1.2 million.
And so you raise two very important points. Turn on marketing, turn on systems. Mm-hmm. You know, marketing today is literally a science. It's not throw stuff against the wall and take guesswork. It's literally a science, especially when it comes to organic search engine optimization. And then systems, very, very important. If you're going to have any success at growing, you've got to have scalable systems. Like we teach our clients, you know, 24 systems they put in their practice. And then when you acquire another practice, you want to put those 24 systems in your practice. Because then all of a sudden you have a finely oiled machine, you know, that is running. And I'm not saying there aren't challenges, but we've got consistency. And we've got a proven system that can take the practice from where it is to where it has potential to go. You're not going to take a practice from 800,000 to 2.5 or 3 without having good systems in place. Otherwise, you'll pull your hair out. And you'll be dependent on people. And when someone leaves, then the practice is going to come to a screeching halt. And that's no fun.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask
great observations on marketing and systems. Marketing systems, you bet.
Yeah, the other thing that kind of surprised me is he's spending less time. I know when we first started, he would talk to us every month. Now we don't even talk to him once every 6 months, but all these four practices are just humming with new patients. So like, that's the beauty of scaling. Like once you figure it out, you don't have to put more time for every practice you acquire.
I would say I'll make a related comment. Your toughest practice will be your second one.
Mm.
Second one will be your toughest because you'll likely have thin resources, you know, in terms of being able to share team members and so on. And that's the one that will stretch you. From there, it should get easier. The plan should be to make it easier, but count on that second one requiring a massive amount of effort on your part.
Right.
But once you get there, like right now, I have a wonderful client that is on to practice two. And he said, Gary, you did. Thank you for telling me this practice was going to be the toughest because you're right. I can't wait till I'm ready to do the third. We're getting there, but and it's getting easier day by day. But he said, thanks for the heads up because I was prepared for it. Thanks to your warning.
Thank you, Gary. The second question is, I currently have 6 locations and would like to add more. There are not many practices for sale in my market. Should I consider a new location? Your thoughts?
De novo location?
Yes, de novo location.
De novo? Yeah. So, you know, that also comes into play about supply and demand. Are there practices available to purchase? Now, don't necessarily just go to the brokers for this. I think I've noticed this among my clients that have grown. Some of the best acquisitions have been what we'd call pocket listings. Naren, do you know what a pocket listing is in real estate?
No, Gary. I heard the term, but I don't know what it is.
Pocket listing, I'm talking about real estate now.
Uh-huh.
It's where a broker knows something is coming for sale, but it's not listed in the multiples yet.
Got it.
And so that real estate...
I think they call it private sale.
The correct term is pocket listing. So,
pocket listing. Okay.
So the broker will tell the owner, if I could find you a buyer, at you tell me the price, would you sell? And it never gets listed.
Mm.
And if the seller says yes, and they sign an agreement on that, it's not a listing yet, it's not a multiple listing, but they sign an agreement, and then the realtor goes to the buyer and says, I've got your house. And it never got listed. By the way, many, many, many real estate transactions never get listed. Same thing happens with practice sales. So who could be your bird dogs for potential practices? How about the supply reps?
Mm.
You know, they're in 150 to 200 offices in your territory every month. They know what's going on. They know who might be itching to sell. They know, and maybe there's a doc that wants to sell but stay on.
Mm.
Maybe he or she really isn't cut out to own a practice.
Absolutely.
And there's many dentists like that. And they say, if I could just put my head down and be a dentist, I would love that. That would be a killer acquisition to make. You know, to come in and, you know, doc said, hey, you can stay and we'll run the business for you. And that could be just a win-win-win all the way around. So, you know, think about it. The reps in your area kind of know what's going on. The local dental labs might know what's going on. You know, and you could even put out an email, you know, to dentists in your area and just say, I'm looking to expand. If you have any interest in, this could be done many of different ways. You could stay, you could leave, you know, this could be structured a lot of different ways. If you have any interest in, you know, in selling and doing it in a really cool way, please reach out to me and, you know, any inquiries would be held in strict confidence. So you can do that on your own. And so I'm still going to recognize what that question was. The question is, there's not a lot available. Should I consider doing a de novo practice? And the answer would be yes. Again, do your demographics, make sure it's not completely saturated in terms of dentists. But even if it is, I wouldn't be overly concerned about that because I've seen de novos in unlikely places. I've seen de novo practices in downtown San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Nobody could make a point of downtown San Francisco being underserved by dentists. I've seen them in Orange County, California, Nashville, Tennessee, Phoenix, de novo practices. Because the reason why you can do a de novo almost anywhere is that 50% of the adults in every community doesn't have a dentist. Let's go find them. Now, one thing I will tell you, if you do a de novo practice, in your budget, in your business plan, fund for marketing. Fund for marketing, because you've got to get patients in the door. Fund for marketing. But yes, I would consider doing a de novo if I couldn't find something to buy. And I wouldn't be afraid of that.
Thank you, Gary. Third question. I have a small group with 8 locations. Our EBITDA is at 12%. What is the best way to increase our EBITDA to the 18 to 20% target?
All right, two things specifically. Number one, look very seriously at reducing your PPO contracts. Reduce those. Now, again, it's not to be done in a cavalier manner, but reduce your insurance footprint, because when you're giving away 45 to 50, if you have a PPO heavy 8 locations, the amount of money you're giving away is absurd. Let's start to reduce that. That by itself can get you from 12% EBITDA to 18 to 20% EBITDA. If you choose to go all the way, we have groups in my consulting that have EBITDA in the 26 to 28% range. Now, if 18 to 20 is good, Naren, how's 26 to 28?
It's exceptional.
It's A plus in their report card.
Yeah.
Now those practices are fee for service, because you're not going to get there sending that much money to PPO plans. So those are fee for service practices that have 26-28% EBITDA. And then the second way is just same what's called in business same store growth. Same store growth. In other words, look at what we can do to add same day dentistry. The same-day dentistry, I've talked about this before, that same-day dentistry can mean two things in dentistry. One is CERAC, where we're doing the crown in one visit. That's called same-day dentistry. I'm not really using that definition here. The other definition is doing more dentistry on the patients that are on our schedule today. Adding same-day dentistry. Every practice has a great opportunity to grow in that area. And I'll tell you that world-class practices, if we come in the morning huddle, we'll look at what's scheduled for the day. World-class practices will exceed that by the time they get to the end of the day, 80% of the time will exceed that. So they have a model and a culture around serving our patients who are here today saving them a visit, helping utilize their insurance benefits, taking care of something before it becomes a lot more complicated and more complex for the patient. And 80%, they don't need it 100% of the time, Naren, but 80% of the time, they end up their day with more dentistry than they started. Most practices go backwards during the day because of cancellations and no-shows.
Right.
But those are the things I would focus on. Same store growth. And
what about marketing, Gary?
I would talk about marketing again. Marketing is another way to achieve all of that. You bet. If they don't have healthy new patient flow, then they've got to pay attention to marketing. And right. Most practices are underperforming in marketing for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And we do work with group practices as well as solo practices. If anyone is interested in evaluating if your marketing is like killing it or not, we can do a marketing strategy meeting. It's equa.com/MSM. If that's one of the ways you want to grow, then definitely we can help you.
And the great news is if they're an Equa client, they're going to have their marketing expense paper thin, very, very low, because all you're doing is organic SEO. You're not throwing crazy money in pay-per-click ads or other marketing schemes that just don't work. And you're going to get great new patient flow. And you look at what percent you're spending on marketing, percent of your revenue, it's going to be really nice to your bottom line.
Yeah, I think with group practices, I've noticed it's like 1% or less, like PPO, like you
pointed out. It's often less than 1% of revenue being spent on. And traditionally in dentistry, we've been taught that anywhere from 3-5% of revenue is an acceptable marketing budget. Right. What if you get that less than 1% and sometimes significantly less than 1%?
All right. Good. Let me ask you the Fourth question, Gary, the last one. I understand that my biggest challenge in growing my group is to attract and keep the best possible associate dentists. Should I consider creating a possible equity situation as an incentive to keep quality associate dentists?
Yeah. So you're absolutely right, Doctor, that the number one challenge will be attracting and keeping quality associates. Attracting and keeping. And the key word is they're keeping. If you have a revolving glass door of associates, it's a recipe for disaster. It really is. It's a recipe for frustration. Constantly hiring, bringing new associates up to speed is just, I don't want to say it's insurmountable, but it is a very difficult challenge. You don't want to get in that cycle at all. And so I like your thinking. Would it make sense to have an equity opportunity? You know, many DSOs have grown. Some entire practice DSOs are built around the idea of partnering with their associate doctors. I can think of one that's big here in Phoenix. And if they have a great associate, they will propose a partnership for the next location and provide a equity position for the associate to grow, because they figure that, hey, here's someone very sharp. I don't want to lose them to go out and do something on their own. And if I provide them equity, it's a form of a golden handcuff. You can make it so attractive that they wouldn't want to go anywhere else. So yeah, I do like the idea of providing equity. And it's beyond the scope of this episode. Maybe we'll do it in a future episode, Naren, to talk about, you know, what does the financial side of this look like? What does an exit look like if you develop a really good a group of practices? It's very attractive, though. Maybe we should, do you think that might make a good episode sometime in the future, Naren?
Absolutely, Gary. That would be a wonderful episode.
One thing I'll tell you is that DSOs, and in particular private equity firms, have not lost their appetite on the dental profession at all. I saw that at our conference 2 weeks ago in Nashville. Private equity is bullish on dentistry, and they're willing to pay handsomely for groups of practices that they can, they can run, because then they get a great return on their investment on that. It's beyond the scope to talk about that, but let's just say, for the purpose of that question, that there's enough money to share with our associate docs. And I would tell you, if you share some of that, come up with a formula for the doctor able to have equity, then your likelihood of keeping them goes up dramatically. Because then they have skin in the game, they have upside potential, they wanna stay because they wanna capitalize on that equity. It could be done very well. It doesn't have to be huge. Because if you look at what the ultimate end finish line would be financially, even small percentage of equity can be very handsome. In fact, in many cases, small percentage of equity would be better to your associate doctor than if he or she went out and did their own practice and eventually sold that. Financially, it could be better to have a small sliver of a big pie than 100% of a pie. That on the surface, that doesn't make sense, does it, Naren?
But I understand math, right? And you are right. It's better to have a small sliver of a bigger pie, like let's say 50 practices or 30 practices, than 100% of, like...
It doesn't even have to be that big. Yeah. I can think of an example in my client base where they have 14 locations. 14. By the way, that might seem big if you have one, but that isn't huge in this world. They have 14 locations. They provide equity. And they just do not have turnover among their associate docs. They land there and stick, and they support them. There's many other ways. You can't just provide the golden handcuffs without providing out. They provide internal CE. They listen to their associate docs. They work really hard on team building teams that fully support the associate docs. So there's a lot of things you have to do in conjunction with that. But the idea of providing equity to an associate doc can be a great way to reduce the idea of having a revolving glass door of associates all the time, because that's a game that you don't want to play, I can assure you. Well, as we come to the finish line today, that was the fourth question. Is that right, Naren?
That is correct.
As we come to the finish line today, I hope we've inspired some thinking on the idea of maybe you becoming a dentist entrepreneur. If you'd like help with that, we coach in our coaching. We work with dentist entrepreneurs. We'd love the opportunity to work with you if that was the case. You can go to thrivingdentist.com /coaching and learn about that. And if you want to talk to me about it, maybe that'd be the best thing to do is we could talk about your situation. You can schedule a coaching strategy meeting with me. Go to thrivingdentist.com /CSM. It opens up my electronic scheduler. Pick a meeting time and love to talk to you about this if I have sparked any interest. On that note, I want to say thanks. Thanks to you, Naren. Thanks to your team. Thanks for all that you do at Equa to help dentists consistently attract quality new patients. Also want to thank our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you for the privilege of your time today. We look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show. Because better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide. And don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. But when you dream, dream big.